Welcome back to All About Money on HKIBC. I'm Chloe Fung. Joining me today is Christine Low. She's a former undersecretary for the environment and now the chief development strategist at the University of Science and Technology's Institute for the Environment. We're discussing the city's green finances and also the infrastructure issues. So thank you for being on our show again. And also following up our previous discussions, it seems that it's also quite challenging or controversial to get the private sectors on board because, you know, they have the financial concerns as well. But then now I'm also thinking, like, as a city move forward, we, you know, you have been proposing that the city should add the carbon tax, for example, in order to boost the city's, you know, new energy generation. But then how would you rate the progress over the past years in the city?
Well, I think what we have, where we are today is people are beginning to realize that there are real risks that we have to face for the longer term. So, I mean, if you're in the private business and you're looking at Hong Kong out in the next 10, 20, 30 years, particularly if you're in infrastructure and in property, I think the companies are already asking themselves, how can their assets, meaning their buildings and infrastructure, be better protected if they are going to be facing, you know, extreme risk and extreme rainfall events, for example. So this kind of risk, they're also companies are also being forced in a way by regulations locally and also international trends to disclose their climate risk. So therefore, I think companies today are much more alert to what it is that they have to do. And in order to make the changes and to raise the money to make these changes in both the public and the private sector, the government and business actually have to work quite closely together. So I think this heat wave right now makes people more alert to having to work together. The good news about Hong Kong is we do have the expertise. We do have the people here who, if you can bring them together in a way to work together for long-term plans, we actually have the talent to do so. We also have the wealth to do so. So if we don't look at this kind of transformation as a cost, but look at it as an investment, one that you can raise finance on from the private market, as well as deliver better services and a living environment for the people of Hong Kong, it is possible to have a win-win situation.
Right. Does it seem that we are getting a lot of things ready, but then what are the challenges that is kind of like hindering the potential of, for example, the carbon trading from further development? But the good news is that this year, the Hong Kong Exchanges and Clearing Limited has launched the Hong Kong International Carbon Market Council to explore the carbon opportunities in the region. And also the Hong Kong Monetary Authority is also examining the need for Hong Kong to develop market structure and regulatory models to link up international investors and with the mainland's carbon market. So how would you see the city's, do you think Hong Kong can be an international carbon trading hub in the future if it's not now?
Well, I just think the opportunities are exciting. And Hong Kong as a financial center, it is quite right for Hong Kong to look at what services it can provide. And obviously, the main market for carbon for Hong Kong to serve is mainland China. Mainland China itself has big plans that the government has already articulated about decarbonization. It has already started a carbon trading market for the power sector. And we know what the mainland government wants is over the next number of years to extend it from the power market, I mean, the power sector, to other sectors. So what the mainland is doing right now, of course, it is just trading within China itself. But the talk at the multilateral level is that there could be international trading so that we can imagine that maybe in the years to come, there will be an international market for trading emissions. Now, obviously, we are some way off from something like that, but development is happening. So Hong Kong doesn't want to be left behind. We want to ask ourselves, what are the services that we can offer in the design and in the restructuring of the potential of that market? So I think that's point number one. Number two is actually, you know, mainland cities are also thinking about quite spunky things. So I think in 2023, Shanghai is working on some kind of emissions trading for credits for individuals. So if you, the idea is if you were doing some activity that is low carbon, you accumulate credits, and with that credits, you know, you can get something positive from it. So there's no reason why Hong Kong can't think about something like that. I would say that emissions trading is a relatively new issue for Hong Kong. I think the government, it's time that it starts to think about it. And in the future, we will see other people doing it.
Right. I think it was very interesting that you mentioned about the personal, like private, the personal credits as well. So it's really about the whole societal issues. But then also on the green finance, you know, Hong Kong has been rolling out the green bonds. But do you think, for example, these kind of green bonds should not only be issued from the administration, but also from the private sectors as well, so that we can all together to boost our, you know, new energy generation while reducing the carbon greenhouse gas emissions?
Well, two things. One is the government is raising bonds, but actually private companies in Hong Kong have already raised bonds. Quite a number of companies have already done so. And why is the private companies doing so? It's because that they can raise money from the private international market, because there are more and more investors who want to put their money into greener projects. So the companies in Hong Kong that have already successfully raised green bonds, the money is being used to help them transform their companies and their assets into something greener. That's how they have prepared their bonds. So I think the green bonds is now, you know, quite well accepted. Banks in Hong Kong are also now doing green mortgages. There are also green loans for companies to get from commercial banks for them to, you know, do whatever it is that they wish to do to make their companies greener. So I think what's important is hopefully this will grow, that more companies, more institutions in Hong Kong will start looking at what it is that they can do. But there's the intersection between the public and the private sector. So when we are talking about major landslide risk infrastructure, you know, flooding infrastructure, those are really public sector investments where the government plays the most important role. But those things are a public benefit. And that's why how you design them, what you do, bringing in people, the community to understand, to make changes for many years to come is so important.
Right. And one last question, Christine. Let's just talk about the new energy possibilities. For example, Hong Kong has its very unique location. We have a lot of natural energy as well. For example, the winds, the solar. And a lot of people are saying why the city is not investing enough, for example, in the solar system. We can't actually, we have a lot of the empty rooftops. So do you think that we can, you know, invest more in the solar panels in the city as well? What do you think about this possibility?
Well, actually, we have relatively limited potentials in solar and in wind, when we compare to other places that have a lot more land or have a lot more sea, right? You know, Hong Kong is after all a relatively small place. So what we are saying is, within this context, where is it that we can generate renewable energy? Now, obviously, rooftop is one. And I think since the government changed its policy by providing a very attractive feed-in tariff, they could see that there has been attractive uptake. But my understanding is that's being lowered right now. Perhaps that's not the right time to really do it. There are perhaps more areas in Hong Kong that we haven't thought of yet. Is there some way, for example, that we can look at slopes in Hong Kong where at the same time we can protect landslides, but we can also perhaps generate energy? The Hong Kong government, the Water Supplies Department, is already putting floating solar panels on their reservoir. Can that be extended? And what is the maximum that we can do in Hong Kong? So what I'm saying is we can count up all of these areas and see what we can do. But what we cannot do in Hong Kong, like we can do in larger territories, is to have giant solar farms and wind farms.
Right. So that's also linking to the, you know, one of the solutions is to have more cooperation with, for example, the mainland in the Greater Bay Area as well to boost the possibility as well. So thank you very much for your thoughts today, Christine. That's Christine Low, the Chief Development Strategist at the HKUST's Institute for the Environment. We'll be back on HKIBC next Sunday night. Until the next time, have a good night.